Good evening and welcome to our Wednesday night service. Welcome to the Central Messages of Hope. And for those of you out there in tech land, we are so happy that you're here with us. We want you to stay with us. You will be blessed.
Amen. Let's just bow our heads where we are and close our eyes as we pray to the Lord. Eternal and ever-loving Father, we thank you once again for your mercies, for your love, for your ever-loving presence. Heavenly Father, you are indeed in control of everything. And whatever is going on right now, we know that you are in control of it. Father, continue to bless us. Continue to be with us this Wednesday night service, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, the sweetest that ever was heard. Tell all the angels in chorus sang as they welcome his birth. Glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Fasting alone in the desert, tell of the days that he passed, how for our sins he was tempted, yet was triumphant at last. Tell of the years of his labor, tell of the sorrow he bore. He was despised and afflicted, homeless, rejected and poor. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell of the cross where they nailed him, riding in anguish and pain. Tell of the grave where they laid him, tell how he lived again. Love is the story so tender, clearer than ever I see. Stay, let me weep while you whisper, love paid a ransom for me. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Amen.
Amen.
We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. Come, we that love the Lord. Joys be known, join in the song with sweet accord, join in the song with sweet accord, and thus surround the throne,
and thus surround the throne.
We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heaven with Zion, that beautiful
those refuse to sing who never knew our God. But children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, they speak their joys abroad. They speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hills of Zion yields a thousand sacred seed. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly fields, so walk the golden streets, so walk the golden streets. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion, the beautiful city of God. Then let our songs abound and every trench we drive. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground to fairer worlds on high. To fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, a beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion, that beautiful city of
just suppose God searched through heaven, couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed, that would buy eternal life for you and me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. but I'm so glad he was willing to drink his bitter cup. Although he prayed, Father, let this pass from me. And I'm so glad he never called heaven's angels. From these hands, pull the nails that set me free. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. Then forever my soul would be lost.
Good night, everyone, and welcome to our Wednesday night program. I know that we are experiencing some difficult times, and I just encourage us all to be prayerful for our country and for the events that are occurring. But tonight we have a program for you and a message that everyone wants a happy ending. And I imagine in times like now, we want one more than ever. But in October of 2009, a children's program called Something Special chose to change a few words to a very familiar nursery rhyme, Humpty Dumpty. The writers of the show, which aired on a BBC affiliate, concluded that the nursery rhyme was too traumatizing for children. Now imagine this decision probably came after some discussion and some consultation with maybe therapists or psychologists, and they determined that the nursery rhyme needed a more cheerful ending. Instead of Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall, Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. They decided that Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall, Humpty Dumpty had a great fall, all the king's horses and all the king's men will make Humpty happy again. Now, I know that we want happiness. And maybe some people looked at that as political correctness gone amok. But the fact is, everyone wants a happy ending. I invite you to pray with me. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we just briefly look at your word, help us to understand, how do we really achieve a happy ending? What does it take? Help us to this end is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I decided to look at some stories out of the book of Isaiah. Now, Isaiah is a very, very large book. And we're just going to look a little bit in Isaiah in three different areas. And we're going to start with our scripture for today, which is found in Isaiah 1, 18 through 19. I happen to have King James, the New King James Version, and we're going to read it. Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. And we're going to just take a very quick look at a few stories. Now, Isaiah, he faced difficult times. Well, let me tell you a little bit about Isaiah first. He was a royal descent. He was a politician, a statesman, and he was called to the ministry at the age of 16 years old. And he ministered for some 60 years under the reign of four successive kings of Judah: King Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and King Hezekiah. Now, during this ministry, he faithfully warned the people of their sins. He faced the wrath of kings and even faced his own insecurities. Now, it was a dangerous thing to anger a king, even if that king was your family member. Now, being of royal descent, Isaiah was undoubtedly related to every king from the royal line that sat on the throne. And, of course, the king, line of succession went from the son of the king became the king. Now, let's just take a little look into some of the stories in Isaiah, because we want to find some happy endings. Let's look at three areas. Now, Isaiah had a fight with national apostasy. Now, in the first five books of Isaiah, we're going to look at the first five books of Isaiah. We'll look at the restoration of the health of Hezekiah, and we'll look at God's confirmation of Isaiah's call to the ministry in looking for a happy ending. Now, Isaiah faced a daunting task. The leadership had reached such a low level that Isaiah says in Isaiah 1:10, he says, "Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the law of our God, you people of Gomorrah." He was calling the people of God, Sodom and Gomorrah, the rebellious cities of the plains in which there was not even 10 righteous people to be found to keep the city from being destroyed. In addressing the sins of the people, he says, in Isaiah 1:3-4. He says, "The ox knows his owner and the donkey its master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people do not consider. Alas, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a brood of evildoers, children who are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked to anger the Holy One of Israel. They have turned away backward." Here, he's comparing the people of God, the chosen nation, to dumb, lowly beasts. And he's saying that the dumb, lowly beasts had better sense than the wayward people. And finally, in Isaiah 1:11-15. He's saying, God, I'm summarizing here. He takes no delight in burnt offerings, the calling of assemblies, or many prayers. He says in Isaiah 1:16, he says, "Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes, cease to do evil." Now, Isaiah's ministry bore fruit because, unlike the northern kingdom, Isaiah And the nation of Israel, they were able to maintain things a lot longer before they went into captivity. So I say that's, if you can work with me, I kind of feel like that was kind of like a little bit, it gives me a happy feeling that his ministry postponed the judgment of God upon the people. Now these are all familiar stories. Hezekiah, the story of Hezekiah is told in both Chronicles and Isaiah, and we're going to look just a little bit at those stories. I'm reading out of Isaiah verses 38, 1 through 5. I'm not going to read every bit of it, but just so we have an idea. And like I said, it's a very familiar story. It says, In those days, Hezekiah was sick near death. And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, went to him and said, thus said the Lord, set your house in order. Wow. Man, can you imagine how that felt? To be told to set your house in order. You're going to die. Get your affairs together. And Hezekiah turned his face toward the wall, and he prayed to the Lord and said, remember now, O Lord, I pray, how I walk before you in truth with a loyal heart and have done what is good in your sight. Oh, we have a merciful God. We have a loving God. And the Lord says to Isaiah, go and tell Hezekiah, thus said the Lord your God, I've heard your prayer. I've seen your tears. Surely I will add to your days 15 years. Now, I don't know about you. That's a feel-good moment for me. That I will add 15 years to your life. In 2 Kings 20, verses 3 through 6. The same story is repeated. I like one part about it. It says that Hezekiah wept bitterly, and it happened before Isaiah had gone out of the middle court. The word of the Lord came to him saying, return and tell Hezekiah, the leader of my people, thus saith the Lord, I've heard your prayer. Isn't that a good feeling? God heard the prayer of of Isaiah as he brought his petitions before him. Now, what about Hezekiah himself? Or excuse me, Isaiah himself. In the 6th chapter of Isaiah, it's not the beginning of Isaiah's ministry. Isaiah had already began his ministry in chapters 1 through 5. But Isaiah was going through a crisis. He didn't feel like maybe he was worthy. He didn't feel like he was maybe up to the task that he was given. Listen to the words of Isaiah as we look at Isaiah 6, 5 through 7. Isaiah says, woe is me, for I'm undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts, and then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it on my mouth and said, lo, this has touched thy lips, and thy iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged. Have you ever felt like you're unworthy? Have you ever felt like you're unprepared? Have you ever felt like you're not up to the task?
But Isaiah got a confirmation that even though he felt unworthy of the task of maybe he was taken aback by the scope and the size of the problem that he faced, he got the assurance that you are accepted, you are forgiven, and you're cleansed. Oh, wow. That's a beautiful story. Doesn't that make you feel good? We've had three nice, beautiful stories about Isaiah. I'd like to go to the end of Isaiah and tell about Isaiah's prophecies of a new heaven and a new earth and all that. But I want to get to the end of the story. What happened to Isaiah? Jewish tradition from the Talmud, along with Christian historians like Josephus, they tell the story that Isaiah was placed in a tree and he was sawed in half. Not exactly a feel-good moment. Isaiah was faithful. Isaiah did everything the Lord would have him to do in discharging his duties. But yet, on the surface, the story doesn't seem to have a happy ending. To understand that ending of Isaiah, we kind of need to look a little bit at the book of Hebrews. I'm just going to read just a little bit, not much, just a little bit. You know, it talks about people that were stoned, that were sawn asunder. That's a reference to Isaiah. He was sawn asunder, that were tempted, that were slain with the sword, that wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, and tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. You see, there's only one way we're going to have a happy ending to this story. Is that we understand that no matter what happens in this life, that we are citizens of another land. And we are looking for a land and a kingdom that's made by God. And with that in mind, in Hebrews 12:1, it says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Now, I'd like to read a quote from one of my favorite authors from a book called Patriarchs and Prophets. It says, "God would have his people in these days review with a humble heart and a teachable spirit the trials through which ancient Israel passed, that they may be instructed in their preparation for heavenly Canaan." Now, many look back to the Israelites and marvel at their unbelief and murmur, feeling that they themselves would not have been so ungrateful. But when their faith is tested, even by little trials, they manifest no more faith or patience than did ancient Israel. Now, my friends, I don't know whether or not you have tried my Jesus. I don't know whether or not you've put your faith in him. But those heroes of faith, they love not their lives unto death. And they follow. Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice, and they follow me wheresoever I go. Is Jesus the shepherd of your life, my friend? Do you follow him wherever he goes? Could you have maintained even a portion of the courage of a person like Isaiah, where he had to stand up to family members in the royal family? He had to stand up to rebellious people, and he had to even face his own insecurities. You know, Humpty Dumpty, we could change the things all, you know, all we want, but we're not going to have a real victory except we grab a hold of the source of victory. You know, in preparing to close, we have this wonderful invitation. Jesus himself could have said this when he says, come, let us reason together. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red as crimson, they shall be as wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. Are you willing? Are you obedient? Do you want Jesus as your shepherd? If you do, I invite you now to pray with me. Dear Jesus, we are so thankful for your sacrifice on the cross. We are so thankful for the examples of all those who have went before us in dying, whom the writer of Hebrews declares the world was not worthy of. And Lord, right now, we know that we are undone. And like Isaiah, we are unclean. We have unclean lips amidst an unclean people. And we ask that you would just cleanse us and make us righteous, because, Lord, we know that we have no hope other than you. Lord, we want you to be our Savior. And we simply ask that you come into our hearts and dwell in our hearts and make an abode in our hearts and live with us, so that when you come, as you've promised, and you've prepared a place that we might go and be with you throughout all of eternity. Oh, Lord, help us to this end. Help our nation. Help us individually as we humble ourselves to you, knowing that we need your help like never before. Help us to this end is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.